lovely to have author Rosa Chadwick Benson from Litchfield come to join us today to tell us of her adventures. She has many stories to tell us, very inspirational.
Did you know Ava's car over?
So please welcome Rosie.
Thank you, and Marilyn, I want to thank you for matching my book cover. First off, my publisher allowed me to use my own photography for the cover, so I'm very excited about that. And I also have some greeting cards with my photography that they asked me to bring with. So, they asked me to speak. Appreciate having such a wonderful crowd here today. It feels like spring outside. Life changes when you wake up and hear machines keeping you alive. During the fog of my pain in the 1990s, I was told I had days to live. Actually, they told me I would be lucky if I had 20 to 30 days. I was wasting away. I had lost over 100 pounds because of an autoimmune disease that was attacking my body. I could not eat. I could not drink. And I can still not eat or drink orally. I am attached to a tubing where I get formula. I have a 3-foot tube inside of me that keeps me alive. After unsuccessful means in the 90s to keep me alive, they suggested, Gary and Colleen, a life-changing surgery through tubal means through my intestine. An intestine is not intended to function like a stomach, but the surgery was worth a chance. Welcome. I think there's a chair here. There's two chairs. Colleen and Mary, there's two chairs up here if you want.
There's two chairs up there.
When you came that I'm in the hospital in the 1990s and I've been given 20 to 30 days to live. They did a tubal surgery by ways of my intestine. Now, an intestine isn't intended to function like a stomach, but the surgery was worth a chance. While I laid motionless in the hospital bed, a lady chaplain anointed me with holy water. I am the way, the truth, and the life. John 14:6. In the solitude, I had to find the inner fortitude, determination, will, and perseverance to fight, to live, and make it through another night. Or I felt I would fall through a trap door of depression. After 3+ weeks in the hospital, I pleaded to be sent home as I wished to be what was presumed to be my last days in my own surroundings with my family. A few hours after being sent home, and it was basically, I say hours, but from what they tell me, I had just gotten placed in bed and they had to call the rescue squad. When the rescue squad arrived, I remember hearing garbled voices and swaying images And I was following this dazzling bright light. I felt like I was as light as air while floating into total brightness. Loving warmth saturated me in a peacefulness I had never experienced before. It was beyond beautiful. I was entering heaven. I feel that courage is born in challenges, and at that point, God's grace and human intersection was so peaceful that there really are no words. I just know that the best is yet to be. I felt myself struggling to stay in heaven, but also go back to my son who was next to my bedside. And at that juncture, I felt I was caught in between two worlds. I heard someone say, "Take some deep, even breaths." I felt myself being lifted back onto my mattress of my bed to endure suffering what some would consider not humanly possible because I'm not able to take pain medication orally. Heaven was put on hold. I wept in indescribable fatigue and pain. And during the next hours, that became days, that became years, I have learned what patience means. I have learned how to cope and how to find courage while not being able to eat and not being able to take medicine orally for uncontrollable pain levels and not being able to drink orally. Now, some people look at my formula and they say, "Well, you are being fed," and that's true, but it does nothing to abate my hunger. I'm always hungry and I'm always thirsty. I feel like not all scars are visible and not all wounds heal and not all illnesses can be seen. Not all pain is obvious. Everyone in this room has gone through something, and sometimes you just can't relate, even as if you would try to. After countless surgeries, over two decades later, I'm here to tell my story. And I know God has carried me on this whole journey, because why else would I be here? A lady in my local town did a newspaper article when my book came out in December, and she called me a medical miracle. I feel I am fortunate to feel God with me each second, and I feel He has told me if I don't focus on my hunger for food and my thirst for liquid, but if I focus on His love, I will be satisfied. I embrace each moment as I listen to the sounds around me. Last week, if you remember, it snowed. It was not like today. And I was bedridden because I had a surgery on February 14th. And I listened to the snow crunch and I thought, wow, I have one more week to heal before I go to Eden Valley. How am I going to do that? Because I was not feeling well. But again, God carried me. He wants me, I feel, to share with you my journey. God bestowed upon me motherhood in a very special way. And you can read about that in my book. I'm not going to elaborate on it, but it gives me even more determination to fight to live for my son. And he's going to be married this autumn. I never thought I was told you're never going to see your child graduate from grade school. You know how they put on the little graduation ceremonies in grade school. Here I am, I'm going to get to see him graduate from high school, college, and his marriage. In 2014, I had another major colon surgery. They had to take out sections of my colon and make a new stoma for a tubing for my intestine. I was in the hospital 17 days, and then I was told that they wanted to put me in a nursing home for 100 days to heal and get rehab. And I thought, oh, 100 days, I don't know if I can do that. So I opted to have home health care. Immediately upon getting home, I realized I had probably made the wrong decision. I have a split level home, and I was in the entryway, and they had the wheelchair, and they're like, okay, now, how are we gonna get you up these steps? How are we gonna get you into bed? But it all worked out. During that time, because I was so weak and so dehydrated and so lacking in nutrition, I feel those were the main reasons. It was like deja vu of the 1990s again. A rescue squad showed up. I again experienced the bright lights of heaven. And as I was healing in weeks to come, I was bedridden for months after that. At 3:03 every morning, which is the number of the house where I was brought up, I would get a word. And I felt these words were coming from God. And when an aide would come in the next morning, I'd say, could you write down the word patience? Could you write down the word enduring? Could you write down His grace will see you through? She gladly wrote down those words because I was too weak to do so. As the weeks progressed, I gained strength through physical therapy and rehab therapy, and I was starting to write down my own words. Well, once she got me up, after several months, with her help and the use of a walker, I asked her to bring those words to me because she got me from the bedroom to the living room. And I looked at all those words and I had a pile like this. And I thought, what does God want me to do with these words? I had no idea. I had not sat down to write this book. So I compiled the words into sentences and paragraphs, and they became my journey of hope. And that's why I'm here today, to tell you that faith and gratitude will elevate the height of anyone's existence when you go through struggles. You can wake up every day and think about the things that you can no longer do, or you can dwell on the things that you're able to do. I was so graced when I went for a doctor's appointment. There was a doctor that I was seeing at the particular day, and he goes, "What do you do when you lay bedridden?" He said, "I would go absolutely insane." I know this is the doctor saying this to me. And I said, "Well, I'm not going to allow that to happen." And he said, I told him that I was been given words and I was starting to write. And he said, "I'm going to write a foreword for your book if you decide you want to use it, feel free, and if you don't feel like you have to. I am not going to read the foreword because it's a page long inside, but I'm going to recap just a little on the back what he put. This story will bolster the discouraged to lean on their faith, friends, and physicians to move forward one day at a time, never alone." And I listened to those last words and I thought, how true. We are never alone. Never. God's love is always surrounding us. We're into March, and it's a new year. It's a time to look in the vast starry sky in the middle of the night, and I don't know if you saw the full moon. It was gorgeous. I have cedar wax wings back. This week I have cardinals singing this morning, and I suggest that you each take time to stop and observe God's nature. Smell a rose, kiss a baby, listen to the melody of the bird to enlighten your day with grace. Thank God for each day to reach out and show compassion. Give hope to others, because tomorrow is never promised. There are seen and unseen blessings all around us, making each day beautiful. Give thanks in all circumstances. I realize there is a lesson in everything we face. And when self-doubt whispers through the fog of my pain, I am blessed to see signs of his presence. They're here today with your smiling faces. During those moments, I know I'm supposed to share my story with others. I hope by reading my story, it will bless you and others. Thank you for coming today. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask. Do you have a question, Denise?
Well, I've been around you so long, I don't think I do.
I try to hide my tubing. I wear scarves. years ago, modern technology has come a long way. It was for several years I had an IV pole, and the machine was like about this big, and the formula bag was like this, and they called me the lady on wheels. I was attached to this IV pole wherever I went and had to have help to get down steps and if I wanted to wander outside my home or to get to an appointment. And now, I'll just show you in comparison, from the IV pole, it went to a backpack on my back, which was quite large, and now it's going to a backpack around my waist, and it's just amazing to me how small this is compared to what I did have years ago. And my son keeps telling me, just think about the cellular phones that we have now and how compact they are. Maybe mom, it'll get even smaller. And it may, maybe it will. It amazes me from the machine that it was to this size even.
How long will that liquid in that bag stay with you? How long does it before it's gone? I mean, does it pump to you regular or does it?
Yeah, my particular case, I have to go 24 hours a day. Okay. Now, they thought in the 90s when I was showing improvement, I think it was probably a mind game. They said, oh, in years to come, you'll just be able to be fed a couple hours and you'll be fine. I'm just not hydrated ever enough, even with the 24 hours. I have to go in for IVs regularly. The intestine just doesn't absorb liquid like a stomach or regular eating or drinking. If I could drink a glass of water, like our 8 glasses of water a day that we're supposed to, but I'm unable to do that. So
they do like medication and everything through the tubes or nothing?
No, my medication when I'm hospitalized comes through the IV. We have tried to crush up a pill after surgeries to try to see if it'll go through the formula, but it just doesn't work. It just doesn't work. It's just not large enough. So. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So you'll always be on liquid. You can't have like prey foods or nothing like that.
No, there again, it just does not go through, doesn't go through. And I also have to have surgeries 4 times a year to replace the 3-foot tubing. The tubing only lasts so long. On Valentine's Day, I had a surgery, and they had to work really hard this time. They're not quite sure why this time was different, but my organs were starting to wrap around the tubing, so they had to use 3 attempts with 3 different size snare wires to get this tube released. So that's why I kept thinking, oh, how am I going to get to Eden Valley? I won't have the strength, but I'm here. And it's only been 2 weeks.
And how did you get here today?
I drove.
You did.
I'm just very proud of that.
Wow. All by yourself? Anybody else with you?
Marlene rode with me. She's a brave soul.
Now she said.
And I find something else that's so, it amazes me again, the strength of how I'm carried is because being I have these surgeries 4 times a year, I have opted out of being put under. let's say it this way. Every time you're put under, I feel like you're losing brain waves, and I was starting to notice that. So I endure the pain because I really don't like being put under 4 times a year.
That's brave, not me.
If that's a wise choice or not, I don't know.
What is the cost of your book?
$10.
It's the best $10 you ever spent.
Oh, thank you.
She spent 10 for me also.
Oh, nice. Now, are you related?
Uh-huh, she's my sister-in-law.
Oh, sweet.
I'm married to her brother.
Yeah. Well,
yeah, I gave you one.
Being Gary is here, and he's just such a gem.
I worked with Rosie's father, Elmer. I've been going on close to 30 years, so I was over to Rosie's house many times with the Elmer. And we went to a lot of meetings and things together. And
he had lunch with her dad every day, didn't you, Elmer?
Yes, all the coffee 30 years. In the morning early, and amazing taste.
Here, for all of you Eden Valley people, this is reason enough to purchase the book. Gary does a tribute to my father. That's a wonderful tribute.
And you should tell them that everybody knew Vernon and Joyce Hayes.
Yes.
That Joyce was your aunt.
Joyce was my aunt. My dad's sister. Anybody here remember Joyce?
Joyce was my next door neighbor.
Oh,
I loved
sweet.
Her. I miss her so much.
Oh.
Both her and Vernon.
Yes.
And actually, I was related to Vernon because I was a Hayes. So, yeah.
Well, I can see that. Because I'm curious. So, next door neighbor on the farm?
On the farm. Yeah,
okay.
We're still on the farm. We're just half a mile north, maybe.
North.
South
okay.
of the crossroads. We were north of the crossroads.
Oh, how nice
so.
To know.
And I might have met you at, because I remember your dad and mom from graduations and weddings
oh,
and
sure.
different gatherings. You
sure.
know? You might have been there.
Sure, sure. And another thing that the publisher allowed me to do, and which I am just so thrilled about, because they don't always allow this. I'm able to put personal family photos in there, so you can see pictures of my parents in here. So I really appreciate being in a community that knew my aunt. Anybody in the background have a question?
Thank you for coming.
Yep.
Well, my stepfather, like a foster father to me, he explained, like you did, the feeling of lightlessness, seeing the light, going into heaven, just peace and calm. So you hear this quite frequently. I mean, that it's a good feeling.
Oh, but there's, it's just
hard to describe.
There's just the calmness, the peacefulness is beyond anything I can explain. So then being brought back to the pain, it's like, oh, I can't wait for heaven.
That's what he said too, that he was not afraid.
There was no fear. It was just being embraced with this incredible feeling of love.
That's what we got to look for.
Yes, isn't that wonderful?
Thank you for coming. Make sure you continue to visit and come on over for punch and cookies.
Oh, I will mention one other thing too. I did bring, besides my book, someone had asked if I'd been to Eden Valley before, and that was in 2016. I did illustrations for this children's book. And the author is a British author, and he came to visit, and we put on a lesson in the jungle. And the children here at the library had different parts, and they just did just a fantastic job. So I brought some of those copies with too. I just want to thank you each and every one of you for coming out today. It's a tremendous crowd. And two reporters, I mean, I feel like I'm just really cool. Thank you, ladies.
Give her a hand.
One other thing, so, yeah, if I could, because I'm extremely excited about this. Barnes & Noble contacted me this week, and I will be on Saturday, April 14th from 1 to 3 at the Barnes & Noble in Mankato. I'm really excited for those possibilities. It's going to be really fun because Mankato is also the city where my son lives, so I'm just really pleased that Mankato contacted me before other ones. That's a good question. I sent it to a publisher in Minnesota, and they did not write back to me. They called me and said that they felt their memoirs were for people who had already passed away. And I said, well, then it's not for me. So that didn't work out. But she said, look online for anybody that does inspirational memoirs. Which I thought their company was, the publisher is in Tennessee, and she again didn't email back. She called and said, I don't cry when I read books, but I cried when I read yours. You really touched my heartstrings. I have a contract ready if you're willing to go with us.
Back to my class.
Oh, and what are you teaching?
We're over at the Civic Center making quilts for
veterans. Oh, how nice of you to stop and come over. And what is her name?
Vicky.
Arlene!
Yes.
Yes.
So, yeah, that's what we're doing, making quilts for our pets.
So,
you want your name on one?
Yeah. And Kelsey.
Okay.
Deb, DB.
DB, yep.
Yeah, she
did. Yep, she emailed me last night.
Really cool.
And we'll probably each get a book, so you'll have
to. Okay.
Yeah. How often do you do for Quilts of Valor?
This is our, we've been doing it like once a month. We put it in the paper and always looking for volunteers for sewing and cutting and pressing and volunteer with material or cash. Yeah.
Perfect.
How do you quilt your quilts?
What?
Do you quilt your quilts with a long arm or a tie arm?
I'm in the process of learning. I'm not very good, but
that's okay.
I'm learning.
She is.
So you have your own model.
She's good. Sure.
It's a mini arm.
Oh, mini arm.
Yep. For sure.
Thank you.
Thank you. Deal.
Somebody said you were good at it, so you should stand up there.
I agree. She is. She makes all our quilts for Manana
she's
Church.
She's really good.
Oh, that's shape.
All our baby quilts and all our graduates. And Tom quilts for a nursing home laptop. Vicki Pashon.
Pashon.
Yeah, I can really
You know what? She is a wonderful woman.
I'm not a morning person.
I've got her right here in my phone.
Did you find her? This is the book that you found?
No, this is definitely one. She just signed it.
Yeah, I know David said it was
so
they won the first game, but now they have played
one in
the
place.
Well, I hope it is, but you know what? It seems like they're going out when she's
just
out. Sorry, no problem.
Here's her phone number if you want it.
Oh.
I don't think she'd mind you having it. Okay, her mobile is 320-221-0777.
And I will mention to you.
Okay, 7, yeah.
Thank you.
Well, I don't even know. She said she's just learning the long arm, but now this is volunteerism that she's doing, making those army quilts. And at church, I don't know, I think they just give her a donation. I don't even know, I've never asked.
What we're doing over here now is donations, you know, like for material or cash, so we can get more material or batting and stuff. But if you want to volunteer over there, sew, cut, iron, whatever.
Oh, I see. Because I belong to a quilting thing in Litchfield.
Oh.
And they've gotten so old. I turned into a quilter wannabe.
Oh. Oh, well, you might enjoy going over here with Vicki.
Yeah.
And it's far better.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and who do you give them to?
I don't know where she's at.
I see.
They're veterans.
And it's just in your homes you do it, or
no,
where?
We do it at the Presbyterian church.
Oh, your Presbyterian church. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Is that where the no, what's her name? Oh, who's your lay minister?
No,
I see.
Penner, I think, is a man pastor.
Come on. She writes in the Litchfield paper in the Independent. This week she had an article in there again. This lady. Well, anyhow, I met her through some relatives from Waverly. And she's a lay minister. She married. Vicki?
Okay.
I gave this lady your phone number. She's from Litchfield. Came with the writer.
Oh, okay.
And so she's going to be getting.
It's on you. Okay. Yeah, and I'll put liar in parentheses.
Betty would
I'll be back there.
Did you know Paul Benton?
Yes.
Yeah, he said she worked for him.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. She said she worked for the Paul store.
Yeah, that was long.
Oh, he owned that?
Yes.
I don't know, that's why.
Okay, I can remember that. I know, I only worked as quote over there.
Yeah, with Betty's driving.
From Korea. Well, I know he's a big hunter and fisherman. I didn't know he had a video.
All right, we'll see you.
And he sold that, oh, that videos, okay.
Oh, okay. Didn't Babe Lindholman, his wife work there?
Okay, so you guys are getting.
And where was that at?
It was over in the industrial park.
Here in Powell?
Yeah.
Oh, Babe Lindholman's wife worked there too? Really, I don't remember that. Isn't that crazy? I worked on it, you know, at Mills, I would've worked right next.
Really?
Yeah. Do you remember that video store?
No. Anyway.
Did the public come in or did you mail them out?
We mailed them out.
Oh, that's why, okay, oh, okay, mail.
Sure, sure, sure.
And they used to call me Molly from Minnesota and they never was called Molly before or Sibs or nothing. I don't know how they got.
Was that your?
Are you from Forest City originally?
No, never. Were Herzog from Richmond and non-usually county?
It wasn't.
Oh, Herzog, yeah, treasurer, whatever.
Auditor.
Yeah, yeah, I remember that name, yeah.
Hi Delilah, how are you? I see a picture on the wall there.
Where?
Remember you're on the wall?
Oh, over there.
Yeah, I do see it. Hi Brian, how are you Brian?
Good, Joanne.
I just wanted to pick out some.
It's a book, sure. Good deal. Are we in the kid section here?
Yeah, this is kid section.
Oh, yeah.
Here, well, see if you can get.
Is there room for her over there?
Yeah, you're gonna have surgery Brian.
Monday.
Yeah,
thank you.
I told your dad I put you on the Manana Prayer Line.
Well, thank you.
And they're praying for you.
I think Jessica put you on Painesville, she said last night.
And Dad said, he said, Rosie and everybody, so.
It'll go good.
Thank you. Yeah, Monday morning.
Yeah.
Excuse me?
I said, you look, I can sure tell who you are.
Yeah.
I haven't seen you for a while, since you were a little kid.
I'm sure I look the same.
He probably don't act quite the same.
Yeah, I hope not. I probably wouldn't be allowed in here.
You did good.
Yeah, he had a good trainer here.
Yeah.
That's all kicked out already.
Yeah, that can take a lot. That one.
Yeah, I see lots of pictures of her.
We are.
Yeah.
She had gymnastics this morning.
Oh, where'd she go for that?
She was in the wrestling room at the high school.
Oh, right here.
The first day of.
Oh, I think that was, she loved that.
Did you have fun at gymnastics, Lyle?
Yeah.
She was a scaredy cat.
I was a scaredy cat.
Oh, okay.
She stood in the corner and watched all the other
people. She was pretty timid.
Yeah.
I must tell you that it's your color.
Oh, thank you.
Well, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too. Maybe we'll see you around sometime again. Maybe in Litchfield.
Well, this gal said that there's a lady in charge of kids.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. These little ones that you get at the store.
Yeah.
Oh, very big.
Oh, yeah.
But this lady is coming.
Yep, there's two.
Oh, probably.
Towards the back of the.
Okay.
Yeah, when I was
just with her.
bet you can't afford any, huh?
I do.
Okay. That keeps you busy. Thanks for volunteering, Doc. Drank it over.